We're starting a new series called The Unseen Realm. And the unseen realm, what I'm talking about is there is an invisible world that most of us are not aware of with our senses. It's the world of God and angels, demons, heaven and hell. And it's a world that we're going to be exploring over the next 4 weeks. And rather simply bringing this to you from a theological perspective, I want to look in Scripture. And so I'm going to hit you with a lot of Bible verses today and probably throughout the next 4 weeks. Because I don't want you to listen to it because I said it. I want you to listen to it because God said it. You'll notice that I changed the podium this month. It'll be typically when I teach, I need more stuff up here. And so for the next 4 weeks, I plan on doing more teaching than preaching. I will preach a little. Matter of fact, you'll know it by the time I start doing that here in this service. But I'll probably save that for the end of the service. And what I want to do is teach us from God's Word. And so I want to start in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. 1 Thessalonians 5, 23 says this: "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, some of you all are gifted with the skill of observance. Because as I walked around this morning, I had many of you stop me and say, "Hey, did you realize that you're wearing the same shirt that Josh is wearing?" I said, "I'll do you one better. I'm wearing the same shirt that Deacon Dave is wearing." Now, guys, this is not an accident, and I know that Josh and Dave are my friends because I asked them to do this, and they did it, all right? If I would have showed up and it was only me wearing this shirt, I wouldn't have been surprised because, you know, what we as guys don't like to show up and wearing what other men are wearing. But I asked them to do that for this very reason, is because I want to talk about body, soul, and spirit, and I wanted to leave you with something that you'll remember this, all right? And so as I was thinking, I was like, well, who should I make what in this? And so I decided that Dave is going to represent the body. All right. You can tell he's come up here and he said, "You know, when I go to the gym," he didn't have to tell you that, you know, he goes to the gym. All right. And then I'm going to tell you that Josh represents the spirit, which is the good part. And then I'm going to represent the soul. It's just there. It's not the good part. And so today, as you see us, you'll probably see pictures soon, think about the body, soul, and spirit, because this is the reality. They are real. You may not be aware of one of them. You may not have ever felt or understood, but they're all very real. You see, God's word clearly teaches that we are a three-part being, but few Christians have that functional understanding of how the spirit, soul, and body work together. Intellectually, in our heads, most Christians believe that we are three parts, but functionally, the way that we live our lives, we act as though we're only made up of a body and a soul. Matter of fact, most of us think that we are a body that has attached to a soul, and the reality is we're a soul. That's who we are, attached to a body physically. Most are confused about the operation of soul and spirit and how that goes together. So here's what I would tell you is when you're talking to me face to face, you'd be looking at my body, but speaking to my soul. See, the word soul is defined by some as the mind, the will, the emotions. I'm going to talk about this a little bit more. And while that's certainly true, it would be incomplete without our conscience. The soul is really what people call our personality. And here's the truth. You can feel both with your body and with your soul. Some of y'all that are older, you know what I'm talking about. When you rolled out of bed this morning, you felt the body. When it's going to rain, you're a little barometer. You know it's about to rain. You just tell everybody, a rain's coming. Because you feel it. But sometimes we don't understand how the soul comes. And so I thought of this little ditty when I was a child. It said, "Sticks and stones may break my bones." What's the rest of it? "But words will never hurt me." Folks, there's a Greek word for that, and it's called baloney. You didn't know baloney was Greek. You thought it was Spanish, Italian. Because people can say words to you that hurt, and you feel it. Well, let's start and let's talk about the body. The body is what the Greek called the soma, the outermost man. With this, we have our five physical senses: smell, taste, touch, we hear, we see. There are physical needs and desires that we have, food and water. Maybe we've been getting too much of one of those for the last month. Activity, shelter, clothing, oxygen, and the list goes on. Here's what God's word says about the body. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 7. "Then the Lord formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature." Now, ladies, you knew that men were creatures, didn't you? You didn't need to see that in Genesis. It doesn't mean that type of creature. It means a living being. And so here we see that God breathed into man, and when he did that, Adam became a soul and spirit and body. Jeremiah 1:5 says this, "Before I formed you in the womb." Now listen to what I just said, what God just said. "Before I formed you in the womb." It's not an accident. It's not an oops. God formed each and every one of us. I know some of you ladies are carrying babies right now. God formed that child. And it says this, "Before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." And here's what I want you to hear, that God is speaking these words to the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah is sharing this, but I want you to know that God doesn't change. He's the same today as he was yesterday in Jeremiah's day, and he'll be the same tomorrow. What does that mean? That God formed each of us in the womb before we knew. And before we were born, he consecrated us. He had a plan for each of our lives. 1 Corinthians 6:19 says this about the body. "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God?" "You are not your own, for you are bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." The truth of the matter is, the harsh reality is that most of us struggle glorifying God in our body. We struggle doing the things that we read about in Scripture. Why do we struggle that? Because our body and our soul are different than our spirit. Matthew 10:28 says this about the body, and "do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." You know, most Christians are dominated by what they can see, what they can taste, what they can hear, what they can smell and feel, instead of being dominated by what God's word says. That's tough medicine, but it's the truth. Why is it so hard? Well, it's so hard because of the second component, the soul. The soul is our psyche. It is the outer man. So the body is the outermost man. Now the soul is what we would call the outer man. It's where we have the self, our identity, our personality, our emotions, our feelings and passions. I remember when I was being interviewed for my ordination as a pastor, I have an anger problem. I had it for all my life. I thought it was inherited. I realized I earned it. And so as they were talking to me, they asked if I had any issues. I said, "Well, guys," I said, "you know, I've got anger issues." And I said, "but I usually don't call it that. I just tell people I'm passionate." And so maybe you know some people who are passionate, right? The intellect is part of our soul, the will, our conscience. Also, the evil, the sinful nature dwells in our soul. I'll be talking about demons next week, and I'll talk about how the demons interact with our soul. Let's see what God's word says about the soul. Proverbs 16:24. Gracious words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the body. Now, I want you to understand that it didn't say anything about the spirit. And what I want you to realize is that people can be nice to you. People can say nice words to you, and you will respond in a very good way. Why? Because the Bible says that it is as health to the body. It's sweet. It's received well. But there's more that the Bible says about the soul. Hebrews 4:12 says it this way, "For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and the spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." See, God's word tells us the difference between what our soul wants to do. Through our spirit, it tells us what we should do. And you're going to see as I continue to read is that God's word is not just a good book. God's word is the inspired word from your creator, the one who formed you in the womb, the one who has consecrated you for a life. Matthew 16:26 says this about the soul. "For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul?" The reality on the soul is this, that when this life is over, if you have not had an experience where the Spirit has come alive in you, the ending is not around the corner. So what is the third component? Body, soul, and spirit. The Greek word for spirit is pneuma. Really means to breathe. It's the inner man. It's where we have spiritual discernment. It's where we experience the peace that passes understanding. It's where we get revelation. What do I mean by revelation? Have you ever read a Bible verse? You've read it 100 times in your life, and then one day, it just like, there's a light, and it just like, and you change the way you approach life because of the way that now you read that verse. That's what revelation is. It's the way that we communicate with God. Do you realize that you can communicate with God? Probably one of the... It's shocking for me, but it's no longer shocking. And that is when I encounter Christians that struggle praying out loud. Struggle communicating with God out loud. Folks, if you've been born again, if you've asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, you can communicate with your Heavenly Father. James 2:26 says it this way, "For as the body apart from the spirit is dead." You remember the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eve or Eden? God told them that when they ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, in that day they would what? Die. I read you the verse where God formed Adam. He breathed into him and he became a living creation, a living creature. He had a body, a soul, and a spirit. And Satan tricked them into saying, you know what, you're not really going to die. And the reality is that when they took of that fruit, they died immediately. Their spirit died. I put out on Thursday, the Throwback Thursday message was back to, matter of fact, it was last, the first Sunday of the year. Where I believe scripture supports that Adam and Eve were not walking around naked before they sinned. Now, we've all seen it, and many scholars, if they did a drawing, you know, it'd be a very far away drawing, and you could see Adam and Eve there, and they didn't have no clothes on. I believe that before they sinned, that their body was clothed in light. I believe that when we get our glorified bodies, we will have that. Because have you ever thought about that? What are you going to wear in your glorified body? You know, the one that can go through walls. Like, you go through the wall and the clothes stay on the other side. Is that what's going to happen? Or are your clothes somehow? I mean, see, Hollywood will put this together and they'll explain it away. Sometimes we read in God's word and we never go to the next level. But James 2:26 says exactly what happened when Adam and Eve took of the fruit. For as the body, apart from the spirit, is dead, and their spirit left them, so also faith, apart from works, is dead. John 6:63 says it this way. It is the spirit that quickeneth, or comes alive. The flesh profiteth nothing. When you see the word flesh here in the New Testament, it's referring to the body and the soul combined. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Who's speaking? Jesus. If you had your Bible open and you had a red letter edition, these letter words would be in red. John 3:6 says this, that which is born of flesh is flesh. What's the flesh? Body and soul. So that which is born of the body and the soul is body and soul. And that which is born of the spirit is spirit. If you see that, the spirit is capitalized, referring to the Holy Spirit. See, here's the truth of the matter for all of us. If you are only born one time, you will die twice. That's the flesh. The flesh will physically die. One day, you'll be in a casket or you'll be in a crematory. But your soul is not going anywhere. Your soul will still continue to exist. And the Bible says in Revelation that there's a second death. And it's a physical death too. Or we can be born twice. John chapter 3, this is where he's talking about to Nicodemus. And Nicodemus asked that question, how can a man, could he enter into his mother's womb? Jesus said, no. That one is to be born of the water, and one is to be born of the Spirit. Salvation. 2 Corinthians 5:16 says this, from now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Now watch this. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh. Now, when it says flesh, it's talking about the body and soul. So the disciples, for 3 years, while Jesus was speaking the Spirit to them, he was speaking truth to them, they weren't hearing the Spirit. They were just hearing at their soul level. They missed it. Remember how all the way through his ministry, it wasn't until after he was raised from the dead, and they still struggled with that. Why? Because they regarded Jesus in the flesh. They regarded him as a person. They regarded him as the soul, the personality that they became to know. Do you realize that Jesus left heaven, gave up everything, and became a body and a soul so that he could live a life and live a perfect life and be able to pay for our sins? Continues in 2 Corinthians 5:16. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, what does it say? We regard him thus no longer. See, they might have been slow learners, but they learned. And the reality is this, most of you are going through your walk with Christ and you're struggling. You're struggling with things from a soul level. You're struggling with things from the fleshly level. And you want this magic wand to come out and make it go away. And the reality is, there is such a thing. It's not a literal magic wand. It's the Spirit. 2 Corinthians 5, now in verse 17, says it this way. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He's a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Now, here's the downhearted thing, is that when you get saved, if you were fat before you got saved, you're fat after you got saved. If you were lazy before you got saved, guess what after you got saved? You're still lazy. See, your body and your soul did not change. What changed is you became a completely new creation through the Holy Spirit coming into you. And all things are of God who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. We, if we have asked Jesus Christ to be our Lord and Savior, if you, and here's what I would encourage you, is there's decision cards in the back of every chair. Look at the back of this. This is what the Bible tells us, that we need to admit to God that you are a sinner. Repent, turning away from our sin, from what our soul wants to do, what our flesh wants to do, and believe that Jesus is God's son and receive God's gift of forgiveness for our sins and confess our faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. There's Bible verses with each one of those. I'd encourage you to look at that because you'll never understand this concept that I'm talking to you about until you experience that. Hebrews 10:39 says it this way, but we are not of them who draw back unto perdition or destruction, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. That's what these decision cards are there for. To identify ourselves with those that believe to the saving of our soul. But here's the hard thing about life is you don't build a life of righteousness in the future on a foundation of sin today. That's why many Christians struggle. Is because they want to experience what this Bible tells them, but they don't do what it says. They want to have the fruit of the Spirit in their life, but they don't have the Spirit manifesting itself through the fruit. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says it this way, the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. That's why people, if they just look at God, the Bible as just a good book, it's got some really good advice. There's some wise words in here. It says they don't accept the things of God. They don't accept that Jesus Christ was born of a virgin. They don't accept that Jesus Christ was perfect. They don't accept that he was a son of God, that he was brought back from the dead. Oh, what they'll say is, you know what? He is a good man. He was a prophet. He's a really good prophet. See, because for them to believe those other things, it's folly. And that's what God's word says here in 1 Corinthians 2. And it finishes, and he's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. Because he doesn't have a spirit. He only has a body and a soul. I want to read to you out of James. It won't be up on the screen. It's a long passage. I wanted to read James 1, 19 through 27. It says, know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness. Receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save souls. But be doers of the word and not hearers only. Now, when you get up in the morning and before you leave the house, you usually look in the mirror, don't you? Now, you can confess. I can tell. It is obvious that you all, because you know why it's obvious that you look in a mirror? It's really obvious when you don't. I did this one day. I use hair products. And I had mixed it up. I put it in my hair. And then I went about my day. And it was 3 or 4 hours later. And we were driving somewhere. And then I saw the rearview mirror. And I'm like, hello? I think I used cement that day. And it would not adjust. But, you know, spiritually, we do that same thing. It says, for if anyone's a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and once forgets what he looks like. I forgot that my hair was cray cray. And I just went about my day. And spiritually, we do the same thing. It says, for he looks at himself and he goes away and at once forget what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres and does it, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in all he does. It says, for if anyone thinks that he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unstained from the world. Now, if you're just listening, he talked about two very prominent sins. The first one was anger, and the second one was our mouth, our tongue, what we say. Let me give you a couple of examples what this could look like. A couple months ago, I was talking to a lady here in the church, and she had complimented my wife, and I said, yes, Carrie is a Proverbs 31 woman. And she said, I want to be a Proverbs 31 woman. And so I said, well, what does a Proverbs 31 woman look like? And she kind of struggled with what. I said, well, let's open up Proverbs 31. Let's open up the perfect law of liberty. Let's open up God's word. It was interesting because earlier this week, in a conversation with the same lady, and she says that I don't know if it was this week or last week, but she found herself at 4 o'clock in the morning getting things ready for her house complaining. Now, I'll be honest with you. If I had to do things at 4 o'clock in the morning, I might be complaining too, especially if it's for other people. But Proverbs 31 woman says this about that. Proverbs 31:15 says, she rises while it's yet night and provides for her household. This lady shared this with me. She goes, because I read this. God's word, the mirror, told my spirit that my soul says, you know what? I don't want to be up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I don't want to be taking care of other people. I want to be sleeping in a nice, warm, cozy bed right now. But the perfect law of liberty says, the Proverbs 31 woman rises while she at night and provides for her household. And her spirit changed. Couldn't help myself. I went and I looked up, because I wanted to give you guys some examples. And so I looked up, what are the top 10 most common sins in the church? All right, now I don't know how they got this, but I'm pretty sure it's pretty close. All right, number 10 sin was laziness. Proverbs 18:19, the word of God says this about laziness. He who is slack in his work is brother to him who destroys. Now, guys, I'm not going to show you all the verses that the Bible says about laziness, but here's the reality. If you are lazy, read that. Look at it. Find other mirror of God's word, what it says about that. And now the question is, do we stop being slack in our work, or do we start working as unto the Lord? Another top 10 most common sin in the church is anger. Big surprise, right? What does Ephesians 4:26 says? It says, be angry and sin not. Now, come on, God. Can I have one or the other? Because I'm not very good at being angry and not sinning. I'm going to confess that. Matter of fact, I've got a whole series next month on, it's called The Grudge. And I'm just going to lay some stuff out. Matter of fact, you might not want me to be your pastor when I get done with February. You're like, uh-oh, you know what? We need somebody else. It says, be angry and sin not. And then it gives us practical advice. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Because I don't know about you all, but when I'm mad and I lay down, I think about it all night. Every time I wake up, I think about it a little bit more. And I've never gone to bed angry and woke up less angry. Because now I'm more angry. I'm more angry because I didn't sleep well. I'm more angry because, you know, I found out a couple other things about that person while I was laying there. That's that revelation that I was talking about. The number 6 most common sin. Now, guys, I took this straight from a site, so I'm not making this up. You're going to feel like I am, but I'm not neglecting church. And so what does he mean by neglecting church? Attending, giving, and serving. Hebrews 10:25, consider how to provoke one another to good works by not forsaking the assembling as the habit of some is. Now, guys, I'm preaching to the choir. You know what I mean when I say I'm preaching to the choir? I mean, you guys are the good, you're here. Some of y'all need to be here. But I'm glad that you're watching. But there's some people who've given up on church. There's some people who said, you know what, I'm not even going to do it in 2024. I'm going to waste my time. I'm going to waste my Sunday mornings. I guarantee you they're not provoking other people to good works this year. Oh, I'll tell you what, they're provoking them to something else. The number three most common sin in the church, anxiety. Woo, don't have to raise your hand. Don't have to elbow the person beside you. Matthew 6:34 says this, do not worry about tomorrow. Come on. When you get anxious, all you got to do is open up Matthew 6:34. Jesus says this to you, do not worry about tomorrow. Okay. Now, it is that easy. But here's why it's not that easy. Jesus says to you, do not worry about tomorrow, and then you put that down, and then you start worrying. Pick it back up, you open it up, it says do not worry about tomorrow, you stop worrying for about 10 seconds, you put it back down, you go over here, and you start worrying. The number two, most common sin in the church, being overly critical. I know that doesn't happen here at Crossroads Church. But just in case, maybe you know somebody who's overly critical of other people. Proverbs 17:28 says it this way, even a fool when he keeps silent is considered wise. There's a quote that I've loved, and it says this, 'tis better to keep quiet and be thought a fool than to speak and remove all doubt. That was published in the Evansville College paper, which is now the University of Indiana, in 1923, 100 years ago. They plagiarized the Bible. Joshua 1:8. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate it day and night. Man, I'm so proud of my wife. She is. She did it again. Last year in the month of January, she did a 30-day shred. She's reading the Bible through in 30 days. She did it successfully. She's going to be successful again this year. And you know what? To read the Bible through in 30 days, you got to spend a lot of time reading the Bible. All right? And so now I've backed off. You know, I've been trying to be a good husband and give her, you know, so I ran to Target the other night instead of her going to Target, which she loves to do. I figure I'm saving money and I'm helping her read the Bible. Guys, that's a lie. If I go shopping with her, it costs money. If I get out of the car, it's $100. So when I say, I'm just going to stay in the car, she's like, okay. But it doesn't matter. Target, Walmart, Kohl's, it doesn't matter. I'm buying something. That's my confession for the day. But you shall meditate on this day and night so that you may be careful to do according to what is written. See, if you're meditating and nothing's changed, it's because you're not being careful to do what you read. Joshua 1:8 says, for then you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success. Folks, this is how I applied this when I was growing up. When I was in high school, when I had a test coming up, I studied for the test. But I also increased my time in the Bible because it says that if you'll meditate on this day and night, you will have good success. And I just thought that would carry over onto my tests. It worked out great. Phenomenal. I graduated salutatorian in a class of two. Y'all think I'm lying. I'm not. So I don't know if I should tell people I was in the bottom half or in the top 10, but salutatorian, usually they leave me alone. Let me preach a little bit. Romans 8:5, for those who live according to the flesh. What's the flesh? The body and the soul. They set their minds on the things of the flesh, the things that feel good now. But those who live according to the Spirit, according to the mirror of God's word, They set their minds on the things of what? The Spirit. The things that last forever. We'll read one other big passage to you. It won't be up on the screen. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. It says, "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." Walk by the Spirit, and you will not desire to gratify the desires of the body and the soul. For the desires of the body and soul, the flesh, are against the Spirit. And the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. Have y'all ever felt like you were in a civil war when it comes to your walk with Christ? Like you know what you're supposed to do. You know what you're supposed to do with your time. You know what you're supposed to do with your talent. You know what you're supposed to do with your treasure. And you, all right, I'll give you some time. I'll use my talent, but come on, Ronnie, just leave that third T out of it. It's not Ronnie. It's God's word. God's word says you can take your money and you can put it in bags that have holes in it, or you can honor God with your wealth and he'll fill up your barns and you won't know what to do with it all. And I'm just going to tell you this, if you don't know what to do with it all, you're probably not honoring the Lord with your wealth. I know that hurts. But church, I want you to experience victory. I'm just going to tell you what God's word says about it. Verse 18, "But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law." All right. I drive fast. I've been pulled over twice in the city of Centralia. Both going to hunting camp and leaving hunting camp. I got pulled over. My grandsons were in the back, and they proceeded to tell me that their mother had been pulled over earlier that week. So I knew she was going to find out about this. Last day of hunting camp this past year, I'm driving home a little excited. Woo! I'm like, man, you know what? And I was just telling myself this earlier in the week. I am amazed that I haven't gotten pulled over more in Centralia. I mean, you've got some slow speed limits around here, right? Well, I found out you shouldn't do more than 25 in a 25. Central City, coming down Green Street. Guess I'm not the only one that's been pulled over, huh? I will not say the name of the officer, but he knew me and he forgave me. He had grace. Grace. It wasn't Josh. I was coming from his house. I did. I was dropping names left and right because Josh is an officer on the Central City Police Force. Yeah, just came from Josh Tellison's house. You can call him to verify that. And I'll bet he'll tell you not to give me a ticket. I did not do that. I figure, you know what, I'm gonna take it like a man, and I'm gonna get a lawyer. And I learned that from my wife. She'll tell you, she's never gotten a speeding ticket. I have. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. See, some of y'all don't ever think about how fast you're going because you always stay within the law. I think about it all the time. But you know, I think that probably carries over into our spiritual walk too. Some of you all, when you're in God's word, you never have to think about what the law says. Some of us, we need it. Hey, what was the speed limit? What did God say? Now the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I just talked about last weekend for a lot of people. Why is it that the last Sunday of the year is one of the least attended Sundays? I'll tell you why I believe it is because they know what they're about to do. And they don't want a guilt trip from me. They don't want to look into the perfect law of liberty, and they certainly don't want to hear from it. verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. There needs to be no speed limit. I'm preaching now. Stop. Verse 24, and those who belong to Christ have crucified, have killed the flesh with its passions and desires. I read Romans 8, 5 a minute ago. Let me take you to 8, 13. Romans 8, 13. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Twice. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. I'll just share with you Revelation 21:8. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. It's pretty heavy, what I talked about today. We have a body, a soul, and a spirit. If you've never asked Jesus Christ to be Lord and Savior, if you've never accepted the good news of the gospel that this book shares with us, your spirit is dead. It's dead in trespasses. It's dead in sin. It's dead because it broke the law. I would encourage you, what a great way to start 2024. Not only a new year, but a new life. Becoming a new creation, a new creature. For those of you who are struggling in your walk with Christ, the reason why you struggle is because you're trying to do things in the soul. You're trying to be a better person. Folks, that's not a bad thing to be. It's not a wrong perspective to look on life. But the reality is, no matter how good you try to be with your soul, you'll never, ever have that new life in you. And if years ago you experienced that salvation experience where you asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, and yet since then there's not been much going on, you're not looking into the perfect law of liberty. You're not seeing what this Bible tells you. And here's what I would tell you. If you do look into this and it seems like it's crazy to you, you probably have never experienced salvation. Why would I say something mean like that? Because if I let you walk out of this room today in that state, one day you are going to die. And the Bible says one other day you're going to die again. Let me tell you something about hell. The body that you had here on this earth, you will have a body again. The same sins that you struggle with here on this earth, you will struggle with for eternity while you're burning in hell, while you are being tormented. It's hard. It's tough. But it's the truth. And God's word says the truth will set you free. But you got to embrace the truth. You got to accept God's word. You got to accept what he says in here. And so if you're struggling with one of those top 10 sins, most common sins, there's a Bible verse, probably 100 of them, that talk about it. And if you don't open it up to Proverbs 31 and find out what a Proverbs 31 looks like, you'll probably never be a Proverbs 31 woman. If you don't open it up to Ephesians chapter 4 and find out what it says about being angry and sin not, you'll never experience what it's like to be angry and not sin. How many of y'all like taking open book tests? Open book. It's like, you know, it's something about raising hand in church. It's just like, if I do that, he's got me and he's going to do something else. My dad told me this when I went into the military. He said, Ronnie, don't volunteer for anything. T.I. comes in and he's like, how many of you guys want to fly planes? Follow me. Four of us marched out of there straight to the kitchen for KP duty. 2 weeks later, T.I. comes in. How many of you guys want to fly planes? I'm like, woo-hoo. Four other fools. I don't want you to miss it. I love you. I care about you. I want you to be in heaven with me. I'm sure.